This episode of The Modern Rogue brought to you by Privacy.
Go to privacy.com/rogue and get $5 of free money.
Yeah, what's up? Free money. Hi, knock knock, who's there? Free money, you like it? Take it.
Come on in. All right, we're back with Red Team Alliance.
Hey, brother.
Babak Javadi and Deviant Olaf. Thank you for joining us, gentlemen.
All right, so last time you guys took us on a deep dive of what all is in a mag stripe. Help me understand why RFIDs are any better, or are they even better?
Marginally.
Well, that's a ringing endorsement.
I am a little bit more kind. I think they are better in a lot of ways, but it's important to understand the limitations, just like any of the stuff that we've talked about in the past with locks, hotel safes, or otherwise.
Would it be fair to say that a mag stripe is basically a piece of paper with numbers written down
Absolutely.
On it?
Absolutely.
And then this would be what, a miniature computer, basically? Or
that's actually very close, yeah. So what we're doing, when they moved away from mag stripe technology to RFID, they were looking for long-term reliability and convenience, and also security. Go ahead.
RFID is radio frequency identification?
Radio frequency identification, that is correct. Now, it is important to understand, though, that the R, radio, and RFID is different than how a lot of people can think about radio. So normally, like, you know, if you're listening to the FM radio, you have a station transmitting, and then you have receiving, and that can happen over a distance of miles, tens of miles.
Right, you have a power source.
Exactly.
And in fact, as we learned about with AM radio licenses, sometimes very intense power sources, and then other people receiving
the signal.
With
RFID, it's not a similar situation. You can't really do like super long range transmissions.
Yeah, it's not broadcasting radio.
That's right. So, you know, we talked about how on the mag stripe, it's just magnetizing parts of that rust,
like
that black rust,
basically.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Exactly, right. And instead, they, you know, back in the 70s, developed a technology that allowed them to electromagnetically couple with a coil that powers up this chip, and then that chip is able to talk back to the reader just by modulating its power draw.
Wait, that's been around since the 70s, but
that's right.
It was only introduced into debit and credit cards in the United States a couple of years ago?
Broadly. So this is like the predecessor to what you see today.
Gotcha.
So this is like old original generation technology. And then now what you have today is a lot of other stuff added on top of
it. An iteration of it.
Yes,
okay.
Many iterations.
Am I right? And forgive me if I'm so wrong about this, but is this the same kind of thing that charges my toothbrush, where it's like there's
same
a
same kind of technology?
Okay,
exactly.
Okay. And so this
and your phone as well.
This fancy electronic toothbrush. No, but like I remember in elementary school building a generator, right?
Yeah.
You take a magnet, you spin it around or whatever. So there's waves, and then this is looks like the receiving part of the generation.
Similar idea. In fact, we have something that can show you. So this is super cool. A lot of people have made devices like this. This is basically just a circuit board with some LEDs on it and some coils.
I'm going to be honest with you. This looks like this grants you access to some crazy supervillain club.
It could, or it could just be a card that when you present it in front of a reader, you'll notice that the LEDs that light up indicate that a reader is somewhere in the vicinity. And it's able to draw that power from the reader.
So that card has no battery in it. That card doesn't
correct.
Have its own power source. Whenever you see a reader like this, it's always offering power right into the world.
So anybody who's weird about electromagnetic radiation better be scared of these all the time.
I promise you they already are. I promise you they already are.
So these guys are radiating power at
all
times.
Within a very small bubble. If that makes you feel any better.
Sure.
Yeah.
The RFID card, I didn't know that it had an actual chip. For some reason,
yeah.
I thought it was just a number, basically, similar to a mag stripe.
In effect, what we're doing is we're changing how that number is transmitted. It is still just a number, but instead of it being read off of a magnetic stripe, it's just being transmitted wirelessly. The actual content is not changing. The means by which we transmit the content is changing. It's the difference between me writing down a note and handing it to you and me telling it to you verbally.
So in other words, this thing is asleep until you hold it and
That's
it gets
correct.
Power, and then it wakes up and it goes, hello, I am 1266742.
Over and over and over and over again. You got it.
Is it reprogrammable though?
Some are. The newer versions
okay, are. Okay, so some of them have actual memory in
Yes, we're actually going to see how we can take advantage
ooh,
of that.
Ooh,
yes,
ooh.
Yes. Be excited.
All right, and since this is the Modern Rogue, why should I be afraid?
I would actually call it being informed. Here's
okay,
why you should be
better.
Informed, right? For example, Dave there has our friendly baggage handler's badge.
From your local airport?
From your local airport.
Got it?
Yep.
Okay.
and that grants them access to that particular door. Now, what we're gonna do is we're gonna walk through a very basic card cloning technique just to show you how easily that number that we discussed can be duplicated. So right now we have this card here and that works. And this card here, again, this is the same as any other kind of card. The only difference is we have these custom made with clear PVC, just so you can see all the goodies inside.
Now, is that the same kind of microchip where all it does is shout out a number?
Yes, it is.
But I'm gonna guess that maybe it's reprogrammable.
It's reprogrammable. Yeah.
So it's basically that plus a little bit of memory so
correct.
That you can change
100%
it. 100%. Got it.
Exactly. So right now this card here doesn't work, right? So what we're gonna do is we're gonna use a open source tool called the Proxmark 3, and we're gonna read the data off of that card.
And I assume this is available via the internet?
It is. It is available indeed on the internet. So here we have the number that we discussed is actually saved inside this card, and that's what's being presented to the reader anytime it powers up.
Now, how complicated are those numbers? Are we talking like 4-digit, or is it something lengthy and complex?
Not as long as you might think. Anywhere between 26 and 44 bits of binary data, which is not a very long number.
Yeah. What about the technical side of things? Because this looks pretty, like if I could buy one of these, I assume this software is not terribly complicated.
Unfortunately, this particular software is a little bit more clunky than I would like.
It's open source, man.
Yeah.
If it doesn't work, you can just fix it.
Got it. Okay, exactly. So get ready for 20 minutes when all of a sudden anybody could do any of this.
It's all totally understandable and graspable if you're willing to invest the time.
So at this point, we've captured the number. I assume it's just like the Magstripe thing. You're going to do something where you program the
thing. I am going to do something, right. Mm-hmm. The first something I'm going to do is I'm going to turn this into a card.
Right? Okay.
So because this can be reprogrammed to behave as a reader or as a card, I can actually tell it, instead of reading, what I'll do is I'll give it a command to simulate that same data.
So right now it's just blasting. It's using its own source of power.
Correct.
It's not drawing from
That's
this.
That's correct.
Okay, it's just screaming those numbers.
All right, so we've gone ahead and begun the transmission. So I'm actually just going to hand this to you. Go ahead and present it to that reader on the left.
Okay.
Boom.
Simple. Right? Wow.
You're authorized.
Simple, but like we
can't, you look so legit doing it.
We can't have him running around the facility like this, right? Like
although I wouldn't recommend it.
I would love to see that. He's like pretending he's delivering a pizza, but he's got a laptop in there.
I've known people that like wire it down their sleeve and they got a backpack laptop going on.
Instead, remember this card?
Yeah.
That currently does not work. So we're gonna place that back on here.
These blank programmable cards, totally legal? Are they, how much do they cost?
So they're super
cheap,
couple bucks.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So we're actually gonna tell it instead to reprogram this card, and we're gonna check to see if it wrote correctly. It looks like it did. Go ahead and grab that card and present it to the reader for me, please.
Magic, it's voodoo.
Yeah.
What does one of these run?
About $300.
$300.
Okay.
Yeah.
So a little pricey, but not
terrible.
Achievable.
Now, to be fair, there are like, and there's a bunch of different RFID card technologies out there. We're just talking about like some of the more basic ones, like Prox, for example, is what you're holding.
Mm-hmm.
For Prox specifically, because it's such an old technology, there's really cheap like readers out there, cloners available out there for like $20 on like AliExpress and stuff.
They're like a little blue gun, kind of.
They're gonna do nothing but Prox. And if that's your only game is cloning Prox, then that's gonna be much easier. But this is cool because this is basically a research tool. This allows you to interact with almost any kind of credential if you're willing to put in the time and effort.
If you're trying to penetrate a building, do you go up to the card reader and have to do research and determine, okay, it's this type, and so I have to get the right type of these?
Yes and no. So you do need to do some reconnaissance and intelligence gathering. That's one of the things that we actually cover when we teach other professionals on how to do this, is we spend a lot of time on how to remotely identify different card technologies and readers at a distance just by taking photos.
Ooh,
Dean has taken tons of photos where we can just like that see what kind of card it is.
Question. A key fob is just one of these with a battery in it?
No battery? No, just a smaller form factor.
Okay. Yeah.
Smaller coil, smaller enclosure.
Today I learned.
That's it. Today we all learned.
And much like your key fob may have branding on it, your card may have branding on it, many times the readers have branding and certain very unique visual elements. We say, oh, well, look, the three colored lights, well, that's IO Prox.
Okay.
Oh, look at this, the light bar, okay, that's iClass.
So in both of these examples, you get your hands on the credentials and then you duplicate them. Is there a version, let's say you have access to the, I don't know, the gizmo, but not the credentials.
Right.
What can you do then?
Well, you know how with credit cards, skimming is such a problem?
Sure.
Yeah, same problem exists in access control as well.
That doesn't seem right, because the skimmer, you just put a thing over the thing, and then they slide through the thing.
Or the thing behind the thing.
Yeah.
Yes.
Got it.
There's different things to put in different places.
Imagine a big company that's here in the Austin area, you can think of a couple, that has one of these scanner devices just outside, unprotected. Mm-hmm. You could go up to any number of those and put something in there.
60 seconds.
And no one would be able to stop you. No one would know.
You get two guys who are dressed the same, matching polo shirts. One of them holding a clipboard, kind of look like you belong there. He's watching me, make sure I do my job correctly, and I'm just underneath it, swinging, push, punch, reload,
This
gone.
Is the moment you realize that that's way too polished to be just a theoretical story. That is definitely a factual story that you guys have done. All right, so walk me through this. You guys show up wearing a couple of orange fluorescent pennies and having clipboards.
Sure, whatever works.
Doing whatever this fake maintenance is.
So what Dave is gonna do is he's gonna go ahead and take the reader off the mount. It's important to consider that, you know, this type of problem that we're demonstrating is valid on almost any card reader. It's not specific to these models or brands.
I would not have thought it would be this easy to bust one of these open.
And now what you're seeing is on the back of the reader, we just have a couple of wires. So we have our power and our ground, our LED control, and then data zero and data one. These two wires, the white and green ones, these are the two wires that are used by the reader to send that card information from the reader back to the door controller, which actually controls whether or not that door is open or closed.
Okay, now in this case, it turned yellow. I assume that's what, like a tamper alarm?
That's a tamper alarm that I installed. Truth be told, 99% of installations never use tamper, but I installed it because I wanted to show how easy some of these tamper mechanisms are to defeat.
If you look at the back of this reader, in addition to the wires, do you see something else potted into the metal there?
That's a magnet, because it on this side, I'm seeing what looks like a house alarm thing.
That's right, yeah.
So, wait, so of course, you defeat it with a magnet.
Get magnets. How do they work?
Precisely.
Magnets are behind 99% of penetrations.
Go ahead and put that reader back on. And if you put the magnet, hold it there against the wall as you take the reader off.
It's very Indiana Jones.
You'll notice. Yes, yes. Yeah. Okay, so I see there's a gizmo in here. I assume you installed something.
That's correct. This is actually one of these devices here. So this is an ESP key. This is a kind of interception tool. It's a credential skimmer, not a card skimmer, but a credential skimmer. So this is installed on the wires behind the reader.
You mentioned the green and white wires. Is it just those?
Well, and power as well. So this, because it doesn't have a battery, siphons its power off of the same power that goes to the reader.
But it does have Wi-Fi.
It does.
And so you're storing stuff here and sending it to your phone, I guess, or your computer.
Yes, so right now, that little guy is recording any credential. Anytime someone uses their card to get in, to them, everything is normal. But that ESP key is now recording that information, and because I can connect to it wirelessly, I can actually connect to it here. So we're connected right now to this little guy. Mm-hmm. So this web page is not being displayed from the internet. This is being served up by that little ESP key.
And that's a log of everybody who's been coming and going.
This is a log of everyone who's gone into here. So I can actually just tap on any one of these credentials. And when I want to come in, I can just be like, replay. I don't even have to clone a card. I can just walk up to the door, tap the credential I want, hit replay.
So not only can you get access, but you could decide who to fool the computer into thinking it's coming and going.
Oh, yeah.
You don't just have a key. You control the lock too.
Yes.
Yeah.
And when we dump that kind of data on a penetration job, if we look and say, oh, look, somebody, look at all these people coming back from lunch. Not only does that tell us things like, well, when the building is empty, but if we see someone hitting the door at 1 a.m. and then 2:30 and then 4 a.m., we're like, that's a guard doing a guard tour. If I want to be somebody, I want to be them.
It didn't even occur to me until just now that there's value in just installing one of these, letting it run for a month, and then removing it, never penetrating anything, because now you know the habits and the comings and goings of
everyone. And I have all those credentials. I can take this same card information, and I can use that Proxmark tool to make myself a new card.
That is extraordinary.
And it's not just one, it's any number of them.
That's correct. Yeah.
How much does one of these cost?
$80.
God. It's always $2 at a taco. I can't believe it, how cheap this is.
I don't know that I'll ever be able to do this myself, but
I know,
I would
and you could.
Well, I would very much like to carry one of these around and just kind of like, do you have the briefcase?
Okay,
I agree.
Let's say Jason Murphy did want to become an expert. What would be the best way for him to train?
We actually have professional trainings that we do. You can head over to redteamalliance.com to check out our schedule. In fact, if you take the access control class, I'll probably be your instructor.
Nice. Gentlemen, thank you so much. That was freaking amazing.
Absolutely, guys.
Murphy, I'm losing my goddamn mind.
Wow, okay, I'll handle this. It's cool, it's cool. What's going on?
Everybody on the internet, they're all like, oh, there's gotta be some scam, some kind of switcheroo, some kind of gotcha moment with freaking privacy. What they don't understand is that every credit card company out there is double tapping you. They're making all their money on the fact that they're charging you for interest. They're charging the vendors to make everything happen. And then on top of that, they sell all of your information behind your back, except for one institution, privacy.com.
I order comic books from sketchy sources sometimes that I'm not real comfortable giving my actual debit or credit card information. Like it's a ship in international waters filled with X-Men trade paperbacks that fell off of a truck.
Very unexpected turn, keep going.
But I do that and I'm like, well, I don't want to put my actual card information in there, but it's a really good price.
What you wish is that there was a magic button you could press that would cause a one-time burner card that you could use to buy that stuff that would never ever be traced back to you.
Oh yeah, it is so good. Just go to privacy.com/rogue, get $5 free to spend on it. Try it out with those $5 free. It is so worth it. You're protecting yourself. Peace of mind. Do it.
You guys know that every week we do a free giveaway in the pinned comment down below. This week it's super special. What are we getting? Want to give them a couple of ESP keys for people?
We could do that. We'll give you some ESP keys. And I'll do you one better. I'll give you some of our clear credentials that we had made for us.
Yes, yes.
Can I put it in my skull and get telepathy?
Please don't.
ESP? Would that work?
Don't recommend it.
I wasn't thinking. Not a good idea.